Do something different this morning. You get to sing first. Page 22. Page number 22. There's power in the blood. Page number 22.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Let's stand as we sing on that third verse, standing and singing.
Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would
that's one.
There is power. Service for Jesus your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power.
Thank you.
Jesus. 223, that'd be 243. Victory in Jesus, 223. Now I want you to sing like you know what you're singing about. Singing. I heard it all, the old story, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood about me. And I repented of my sin and won the victory.
Would surely be me. I thought I would be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought I on my own, thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Can't even walk without you holding. 'cause I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Amen. Well, I've never been to heaven. I've never had a vision like some people claim they have. I've never been up there for 30 minutes and come back. It's always kind of funny to me when people say they've been to heaven and seen Jesus. They never do come back and tell us what he looks like.
Yeah.
They never mention the nail prints in his hand, nothing like that. But I know one thing, by grace through faith, maybe I'm going to heaven someday, and I believe that heaven is real, don't you? Someday I'm going to heaven, a place I've never been. And I'll live up there forever in a world that I never shall end. Thank God I'll have a new body, I'll live forevermore. I'll sing and shout with the angels over on that beautiful shore. So many clouds are gathering, sometimes I can't hardly see. But I caught a glimpse of heaven, and oh, what a sight I did see. I can see the saints all shouting all around God's great white throne. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home. I can hardly wait to tomorrow when we'll all be together again. I'll get to see my mother when it says, my child, come on in. We'll stroll through the hills of glory, we'll sing a brand new song. We'll all be so happy, thank God I'm on my way home. So many clouds are gathering, sometimes I can't hardly see. But I caught a glimpse of heaven, and oh, what a sight I did see. I can see the saints all gathering all around God's great white throne. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home. Amen. Amen.
Angels don't know what we know.
That's right, brother. Amen.
Angels never knew the joy that's mine, for the blood has never washed their sins away. Though they sing in heaven, there will come a time when silently they listen, yeah, to me sing Amazing Grace. And it's a song holy angels cannot sing. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. It's a song holy angels cannot sing. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Holy is the Lord, the angels sing. Around the throne of God continually. To join their song will be a natural thing.
Come on,
but they just won't know the words to love lifted me.
That's right.
And it's a song holy angels cannot sing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. And it's a song holy angels cannot sing. I once was lost, but now I'm found. If I could only lay down these burdens and go home, Lord, I know you built for me somewhere a brand new home. Lord, I know you really care for me down here below. So I'll just carry these burdens, Lord, beneath this heavy load. Cause some morning yonder I'm gonna sit down by your side. There'll never be another tear to run down from my eye. There we'll talk things over, Lord, like we never had before. And we'll stroll down the streets of glory, walk by the peaceful shore. This life is sometimes lonely as I walk through this dark place. But I must fight my battle, Lord, to ever win this race. But I know that Jesus loves me, and I know he really cares. And when I get to heaven, Lord, gonna wipe away all of my tears. Cause some morning yonder I'm gonna sit down by your side. There'll never be another tear to run down from my eyes. There we'll talk things over, Lord, like we never have before. And we'll stroll down the streets of glory and walk by the peaceful shore. And we'll stroll down the streets of glory and walk by the peaceful shore. Peaceful shore.
I was saved when I was 10 or 11 years old in Vacation Bible School. This song applies even to a little kid. Once my soul was astray from the narrow way, I was wretched and vile as could be. Then the Savior in love,
yes,
breathed me peace from above. When he reached, yes, down his hand for me. When the Savior reached down for me,
yes,
when he reached way down for me,
yes,
I was lost and undone, without God or his Son. When he reached down his hand for me, I was near to despair when the Lord found me there, and he showed me that I could be free. Then he lifted my feet, gave me gladness complete. When he reached down his hand for me, when the Savior reached down for me,
Come on.
For me, I was lost and undone without God or His Son. When He reached down His hand for me, now my heart doth rejoice since I made Him my choice. In the tempest to Him I can flee, there to lean on His arm, safe, secure from all harm, since He reached down His hand for me. When the Savior reached down for me, when He reached way down for me, oh, I was lost and undone without God or His Son. When He reached down His hand for me.
Yes,
hallelujah, what a Savior.
Yes,
who can take a poor lost sinner, lift him from the miry clay, and set him free. I'll ever tell the story, shouting glory, glory, glory. Jesus ransomed me. Hallelujah.
Yes, preach it. Amen. You go ahead. Amen.
Things up just a little bit this morning, and it seems like it just confuses everything, doesn't it? So we'll go back to plan A next week. I don't care what we do, let's just have church. Amen. You know what, I believe that the house of God ought to be run in order, decently and in order. Amen. And I believe you ought to, it's just me now, I believe in having a schedule, I believe in having an arrangement of how things ought to be. But brother, I believe we ought to take time and do a little shouting, raising our hand. It's all right to say amen and glory to God and look like you're out of order if you want to look that way. But praise the Lord, just lift Him up, amen. This is church, folks. We're here to celebrate, not here to keep a schedule. Although we got a schedule, I respect you coming here and listening to us preach, and I respect your time, and we're going to try to get you out of here on time. But amen, if God gets in this place, let's just hang out with Him for a while. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I don't ever want to be too proud where I can't lift my voice and say, thank you, Jesus. Amen. And if it disrupts the schedule, it just disrupts the schedule. Amen. Well, glory to God. Well, open your Bibles up to the book of Hebrews this morning. Book of Hebrews, chapter number 11. You'll know automatically what chapter that is. It's called the Faith Hall of Fame, the Hall of Faith chapter, I guess some people call it. I just call it Hebrews chapter 11. Amen. Hebrews chapter 11. Glad to see everybody here today. You don't know this, and I'll just confess it to you. Some of you that are here today, I prayed, Lord, help them to feel good today. Let them be here. Help them. I pray they've had a good week so that they could be here this morning. And I look out here and I see prayer being answered today. Amen. Amen. Glory to God.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 1, gives us the definition of what faith is. Amen. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. Let's read that again. That's an important verse. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Wow. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he, being dead, yet speaketh. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Here's our text verse. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Yes. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for your holy word. Father, thank you that these worlds were formed at the word of God. Things that we can't even see, nothing, something came from nothing, and it's by the voice and the word of God that it happened. Father, thank you for that. We believe that today. Father, I pray that you bless me, Holy Spirit. I pray, God, there be something in this message and in this service for every soul that's here, every person listening in our video audience, and we make them welcome today. And I pray, God, if somebody's here, in this audience or in the video audience has never been saved, I pray they'll be convinced today of the Son of God who laid down his life for them and rose from the dead for them to be saved. Father, have your way now in Jesus' name, I pray. And everyone said, amen. Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith, without faith, without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. From the time that he was a small child and able to comprehend right from wrong, his mother would share the Bible with him every single day. In the evening, just before bedtime, she would open up the scriptures to him and explain the meaning as she could. Then she would hold the Bible up and she would say, "This Bible is the Word of God." And she would say to her young son, "Repeat after me, this Bible is the Word of God." He would say, "This Bible is the Word of God." And she would say, "Say it again." And he would say, "This Bible is the Word of God." And she would say, "Say it again." And he would say, "This Bible is the Word of God." This process went on all through his childhood, every day and every night, year after year. Even in his teenaged years, before he'd go to bed at night, he would stand before his mother and say, "This Bible is the Word of God." The day came when he grew up and he got old enough to go to college. And when he attended his first class, the college professor scoffed at the Bible, saying it was made up fairy tales. Well, this shook the young man. All his life he had been taught that the Bible was the Word of God and that its contents were all true. He informed the professor that day that his mother told him that the Bible is the Word of God. Laughter broke out into the classroom. The professor seemed to have all his ducks in a row defending his argument. The young man could only defend his side of the argument with, "Mama told me that the Bible is the Word of God." He left that college classroom a little bit humiliated, and for the first time in his life, he began to doubt what Mama had taught him about the Bible being the Word of God. He went home and he prayed and he said to God, "God, I need to know if this Bible is the Word of God. So I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to start at page one and I'm going to read every single chapter of this Bible. And if this Bible is true, I want you to reveal it to me. And if it's not, I will close the book and never read it again." During that time, every single day, he would get down on his knees and he would read the Bible until he read it through. During that time, alone reading the Bible, just him and God, it was revealed to him that the Bible is the Word of God, and he never doubted it afterwards, no matter what anyone else would ever say differently. You know, there was a danger facing this young man. The danger was this: if he would have come to the conclusion that the Bible is false, then he would have decided that God does not exist. Today, I want to do my best, the best that I know how. With the help of the sweet Holy Spirit, I hope I can convince you why I believe that God exists. Now, I look around this room today, and perhaps in our video audience, just about everybody listening, and you folks that are here today, I don't have to convince you. You've already been convinced that God exists. But maybe there's somebody here today that's never been saved and you're still wondering about this thing about God and Jesus and Holy Spirit and the Bible and church and gospel singing and all that sort of thing. And maybe if you're a Christian here today, maybe something that'll be said that will help you and give you some ammunition. So when you speak to somebody who claims to be an agnostic or an atheist, maybe you'll have something here the Holy Spirit today can use and help guide them and lead them to Christ. Amen. I tell you what, folks, I believe that the Bible is true, and I believe that God exists. Amen? Perhaps as long as multimedia exists, someone in the future might be wondering about God, if He exists, if He's real or not. Maybe they'll run across the YouTube channel of Graceway Fellowship Church, maybe years down the road, and maybe they'll listen to this message, and with the aid of the Holy Spirit of God, they might be convinced to realize that God is real, and the Bible is real, and they'll have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen? Amen? You know what? Knowing that God exists is a matter of faith. It is a matter of faith. Amen? Our text verse told us that he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. You know, I may not have, in your opinion, any tangible truth today or evidence that we can see or that we can touch, but there are ways in which I believe that God reveals Himself to us. It would be impossible for you to be saved if you do not believe that God exists. It's literally impossible for any man or woman or boy and girl to ever be saved if they do not believe that God exists. And we must convince the world today that God exists. Amen? It's like the old-time preacher said, though, I can furnish the point, but I cannot furnish the intelligence to see it with. And that's the truth. I believe in God's existence wholeheartedly with no apology. And maybe my illustrations today, maybe they won't have the flair of someone with higher education, but I'm more than comfortable in that God has chosen the foolish things of this world to prove His existence and to confound the wise. Amen? And by the way, what the world considers wise, God has called foolishness. The first way I want to point out that God exists is through creation. God's existence through creation. The Bible says in Romans 1:20, it says that the invisible things are clearly seen, that proves God exists. His eternal power, His divine nature through what He has made. You know, think about the things that you and I cannot see. How about the microscopic life, the cells that are there, and we just don't see them. You'd have to have a mighty powerful microscope to see what they look like. Or how about this? How about wavelengths and light, white lengths, waves. I'm trying to get that out. White noise? That sounds pretty good. Wavelengths in sound and in light. Think about that cell phone that you have right here. And I hope you got it turned off right now. Amen? But I didn't plan on bringing this up here. I accidentally brought my cell phone up here. But thank you, Jesus. This is my illustration. You know, whenever you send a text message, you know what it has to do? It has to shoot all the way up to about 1,200 miles in the outer space to hit a satellite and then right back to that phone that you're texting to. Matter of seconds. Yeah. How does that happen? Well, it's wavelengths, it's sound, and it's things that's been invented. It's things that we can't see, but God has allowed inventors to discover these things. Amen? Think about the things that we don't see. There's cells that we don't see, and the light waves, and they just travel for miles and miles and miles. Yesterday, I got a text message from my grandson Noah over in Italy. Grandpa, how you doing? Noah, I'm fine. Amen. And just a matter of seconds, we were communicating. And think about your cell phone just to pick it up and call somebody, amen? Those things that we don't see. In Genesis 1:1, the Bible says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. When God created the grass of the field and the fish of the sea, when God created the animal kingdom, and when God created this first man, He put something inside of every living thing. You know what it's called? It's called deoxyribonucleic. Deoxyribonucleic acid, that's what it's called. Say it with me. Say deoxyribonucleic acid. I think it'd be easier if we just call it DNA. Amen? That's what God put inside of all of us. DNA is a molecule inside our bodies that contains the genetic code that is unique to every individual. God did that. That just didn't happen, ladies and gentlemen. God designed it. It's called DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. Amen? You guys go back and tell everybody your preacher knows how to say big words now, okay? But it's called DNA, and it is the instruction manual that makes up all the proteins that form our bodies and help them to thrive. The information code in the DNA is hereditary, meaning that it's passed on from parents to the children. The same thing happens for all plant life on the earth and all the animal kingdom. Everything that's living has DNA in it. It's the genetic code that makes that plant reproduce another plant exactly like it, and another one exactly like it, and another one exactly like it, all the way since the day that God said, let there be grass on the ground, let there be trees growing, let there be bushes, let there be dandelions popping up, amen. And God said, let us make man in our image. And God put in you and you and me and you back there and you over there a DNA that describes exactly who you are. Yeah. You know why the way that you look is because your DNA says that's how you ought to look. You know how come you're tall or short or you're skinny or you're, well, and it's because the DNA code says that's how you're supposed to be, amen. And God put it all together. It just did not happen by something crawling up out of the sea somewhere and then forming legs and then forming ears and then growing hair on top of the head and then learning how to lose hair on top of the head, amen. I can look back and I can see my DNA in my grandfather. I have the same kind of hair my grandfather had. I got this slight baldness. I call it slight, amen. But my grandfather was the same way, amen. And I can look up pictures of you and your family, and I can see the DNA code has been passed on. Wouldn't you agree to that? Amen? Amen. Do you think it just happened? No. Amen. Thank you, brother. You're paying attention today. The DNA code says we are who we are because God instilled that in us. There's no other way to explain it. It just didn't happen out of thin air. There's a supreme being, there's a higher intelligence that put it all together. Amen? When it comes to faith, did you know that everyone has faith? You may claim to be an atheist, and let me tell you something. Your atheism is a temporary condition, you might say. You think about that. So atheism is a temporary condition for everybody. In the last day, will bow to their knee and confess with their tongue that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen? Maybe the atheist today, you've got faith. You've got faith to believe that God does not exist. You've got faith to believe that there's nothing out there from something. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If you're an atheist, maybe you believe that you can't see or feel. You say there is no God, and you believe that by substance of something hoped for, and your claim is the evidence of something not seen. That's as simple as it is. That's what an atheist has got faith to believe that there's nothing out there. Well, the atheistic view takes more faith to believe God does not exist than it does to say that God does. That is a fact, ladies and gentlemen. By the way, if you agree with my definition of faith, Mr. or Miss Atheist, that definition comes from the Holy Bible, and God is the author of that Bible. Amen. And God is the author of that definition. There once was a granddaughter who took off to college, and she came home on break, and she told her grandfather, who was a longtime preacher, she said, "Grandfather, the professor says at the university that it's impossible for man to be born of a virgin without the participation of a man." He said, "You go back and tell him that the first man got here without a father or a mother."
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. And you know what? The order of the universe proves the existence of our God. The planets are perfectly aligned. The sun gives off just the right amount of heat to make the earth a perfect environment for man to live in. Venus is too hot. Mars is too cold. Some scientists say that our location in the solar system is called the Goldilocks zone. It's just right. The earth is perfectly placed at the precise distance from the sun so that man does not burn up or man does not freeze to death. The change of the seasons is evidence of God's creation. Genesis 8:22 says, While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease. Ever since the world has been formed and created by God, all of these things have continued to happen all together. In Daniel 2:21, the Bible says he changes times and seasons. You see, God is the inventor of daylight savings time. So stop your complaining, amen? He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings and gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. It can only be through intelligent design that in the fall of the year, the sap of the trees knows to retreat to the roots. And it stays there until the springtime comes, until the master says it's time to come forth and bud out on every branch a seed. Amen. I believe that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I planted some bulbs just a couple weeks ago out there in the front yard, and I fully expect in the spring they're going to pop up because God will tell them when it's time to bloom. Amen. In the Bible, there are scientific facts that prove God's existence. God reveals himself through his word, the Holy Bible. Amen. The Bible is just not a collection of stories, but it is God's inspired message to us. It contains, God's word contains prophecies, historical accounts, and teachings that reveal who God is and his plan for humanity. As we read and study the Bible, we can see and come to know God more intimately and understand his character. The Bible talks, now listen to me, this gets a little complicated for me, so I'm going to put my glasses on because I want to read this to you a little bit, okay? But the Bible talks about plant life on the earth. Plants need sunlight. Amen? Yeah. They need water. They need minerals so that they can grow. If plants don't get sunlight but still have water and minerals, they cannot produce something called chlorophyll. Chlorophyll gives plants their green color. The function of chlorophyll is to capture the light energy of the sun and convert water and carbon dioxide to produce glucose and oxygen. Plants use glucose for the growth. The plants will die without chlorophyll. Now, it's interesting to me, in Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 3, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Did you notice that God created light first? Then he created water, then he created soil, and then, when the conditions were right, he planted plant life. It all has a perfect order, and the Bible proves it. Amen? So do we even fully understand the importance of the blood that's flowing through our veins this morning? Amen? If we lose too much blood, we all know we're going to die, don't we? The reason doctors want us to get blood work at times is so they can get the information that the blood carries about us while we're feeling the way that we are. Isn't that true? 1,400 years before Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Moses wrote in the book of Leviticus, chapter 17, "The life of the flesh is in the blood." The life of the flesh is in the blood. Without blood, man does not live. Blood circulating through our bodies, it carries oxygen to the cells of our bodies. And antibodies, or antibodies, however you want to say it, in our blood, it fights diseases. There is great intelligence in our blood. It knows if we are infected with chickenpox. A chickenpox antibody will target the chickenpox, and listen to this, not harm any other part of the body. Now, wouldn't that be wonderful if the medical community could come up with a medication that they advertise on TV that doesn't have a zillion side effects to it? Yeah. Amen? Yeah. You get the point? Only God can do this with the blood. Yes. Only God can create antibodies that know exactly how to target a disease and kill that disease without killing the rest of you. Amen? Amen. That's what God does. Yes. Amen. Amen. A little leg movement without the shout, amen. Leviticus 17:11 has it right. The life of the flesh is in the blood. Listen to this. Some of the greatest scientists have proclaimed God's existence. Now, typically, the scientific world and the medical world, lots of times they deny the existence of God and said, well, we did this or we discovered this. But listen to this. Sir Isaac Newton, a name that you're probably familiar with from school, he said, "There is a being who made all things, who holds all things in his power and is therefore to be feared." He also said this, "It is unphilosophical to seek any other origin of the world or to pretend," did you get that? "Or to pretend that it might arise out of chaos by the mere laws of nature." Arthur H. Compton, a name I never heard, he was an American physicist. In 1923, he won the Nobel Prize, and he said the very existence of the amazing world of the atom and radiation points to a purposeful creation, to the idea that there is a God and an intelligent purpose in back of everything. an orderly universe testifies to the greatest statement ever uttered, in the beginning, God. Some of our great inventors believed in God. Samuel Morse, who invented the Morse code, he gave glory to his inventions. And the first message sent by Morse code said, "What hath God wrought?" Now that passage is found in Numbers 23 and verse number 23. Great world leaders believed the Bible to be God's word, and they fully accepted the existence of God. I don't have time to go into all of their testimonies this morning or all of their quotes, but here's some names of famous people in the past in our history that believed in God and believed in the Bible. Theodore Roosevelt, Napoleon Bonaparte, Patrick Henry, Andrew Jackson, President William McKinley, Woodrow Wilson, John Quincy Adams, and the author, the great author, Charles Dickens. He said this, "The New Testament is the very best book that was ever written and known to the world." Science, scientists, and the historical world leaders all support the Bible account of God's existence. Well, you know something. All of that's good information, right? If you didn't know that, hopefully you got a little something out of it. But you know, Ray gave his testimony a minute ago. He's 10 years old. Yeah. I was about 11 or 12, somewhere in there. I personally don't require the testimony of anybody or the scientific world or any great inventors to know that God is real. Amen. Because I've had a personal experience Amen. With Him. Amen. Amen. I've had that personal experience. It happened one evening when I was just a young boy. You've heard my story. Not only can I testify that I believe that God exists, but I can say without a doubt or apology that I know God exists. As a young boy, I was in that tent revival meeting one night, and the invitation was given. I felt the tug of my heart to get right with God. I remember that tug as if it was happening right now. Once you've experienced the tug from the Holy Spirit, you'll not ever forget it. That tug was the power of the Holy Spirit of God convincing me that Jesus Christ could save me and make me heaven ready. That's all I knew. That's all I knew. I was a boy, 11 or 12 years old, didn't know anything about the Bible. I just knew the red letters was something Jesus said. Something Jesus said. All I knew was there was something in here telling me I need to get right with God. And I went forward and I prayed and said, "Jesus, would you please save me?" Just like that. Hands up in the air, looking straight up. Buddy, I tell you what, it felt like a bolt of lightning come through me that night. I knew. I even said it out loud, "I am saved." My tears went to laughter. Man, I tell you what, if I'd had a little more moral support there, I probably would have got up and done a little shouting, a little bit of running, not even knowing what I was doing, but I was just happy about it. Amen? After today, after this service is over, we're going to go to the Worthington place and have a church service for the folks at the Assisted Living. That'll be our number 4 church service we've done this week at the Assisted Livings. And yesterday we was at the Miller's Merry Manor, and we had some singing over there and did a little preaching. Had a nice little crowd. Seemed like it kept growing as time went forward. I was really getting impressed, man. I thought, our singing is drawing them in, and this powerful preaching I'm doing is drawing them in. Well, we was in the cafeteria, and we started out with about 8 people, and when 4 o'clock come, everybody coming in started wanting dinner. I thought they was coming in to hear me preach, amen. But at the end of that service yesterday, this man named Albert wheeled his wheelchair up and said, "Hey," I said, "Yes, sir." He says, "I want to tell you something." I said, "Okay." He said, "I got saved at 11 years old in a little town right in the middle of the state of Nebraska. I was 11 years old." And he said, "You want to know something? I don't read my Bible a lot. I haven't read my Bible for a long, long time. But what you said, woo-hoo! What you said about what happened to you at 11 years old, and what God has done for you, and how He's never frowned a day on you since that day. God's never left you. He's never turned His back on you. There's not been a minute God's been mad at you." You see what they were hearing? They were hearing encouragement over there. They were hearing stuff that was lifting them up. And that renewed something in that man's heart. Hey, that was the first service he's ever attended over there with us. But something stirred him up. And brother, it was the Holy Ghost of God. Amen. Yes. Reminding him of what happened to him 60 plus years ago, amen. You guys didn't know that, did you? It was after we all started dispersing away. But thank God for the Holy Spirit of God. What caused him to do that? It's because God exists, amen. And the Holy Spirit of God is sealed up in him forever and ever and ever, amen. And it reminded him of what happened to him one day way back yonder, amen. You know why you get so happy and stirred up in your heart when you think about God, what he's done for you? Because he's stirring you up, because there's something inside of you called the Holy Spirit of God. And brother, he wants you to get excited about him because he likes to remind you of what happened to you, brother, when you got saved under Brother Page's ministry 1,000,000 years ago, amen. Someday it will be 1,000,000 years ago, amen. Well, glory to God. Brother, it's going to stir you up, amen. Because that's what Jesus does. Brother, there's no amoeba crawling up out of the ocean that can get you excited about the things of God like God can get you excited. Amen. There's something inside of us. And you know what happened to us when we got saved? Oh, that DNA I talked about a minute ago, that name. Brother, that all got changed to a new DNA called the spiritual DNA. It's what God put inside of us the moment we said, Jesus, would you save me?
Yeah.
Brother, we became something new. I was just thinking this week, I was trying to get ready for the day, and I got the, I don't know if I was looking at myself in the mirror counting lines or what, but I got to thinking about when I was born. When I was born, God created me and brought me forth from my mother's womb. I was a created being. I still am, by the way. I was a created being. But you know what? The Bible says, amen, that the proof of God, the Bible says, when I accepted Jesus Christ, I became a new creation, amen. God made a change in me, amen. And God made a change in you. If you are saved, you are a brand new creation, amen. Glory to God. Well, praise his name. But you know what? It requires faith, doesn't it? Yeah. To believe that God exists. Yeah. If you're an atheist in your belief system, or if you're an agnostic, that's somebody who's not sure one way or the other God exists, you may have some questions about how all of this comes about. Well, it's very simple. How does all of this come about? If God is real, Mr. Preacher, if God is real, how is it that all of this stuff in the world, and how does my faith come about? How is it that I can make claim that there's the Holy Spirit of God living inside of me? How is it that I can claim that? Well, it all happened one night when some preacher was standing behind a pulpit and doing something really foolish. Yeah. Preaching. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. It's the foolishness of preaching, yeah, according to the world. Amen? And that's what convinces us, because he was preaching the Word of God. And it's the Word of God that has power. And the Holy Spirit takes this Word of God that's flowing from this mouth and sends it out to a heart that's dark and unrighteous and convinces them who Jesus is. They may find themselves at an altar of prayer or simply bowing at their seat wherever they are and saying, Lord, I believe, God, that you are real and that Jesus is your Son. And I believe that he died for me. And I believe that when he was buried, you raised him up. And God, I accept the free gift of eternal life now.
Yeah.
Amen. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. Requires faith. The Holy Spirit is God's presence within us as believers. And he guides the born-again believer. He convicts the world of sin. And he helps the believer to understand spiritual truths. Amen. Through the Holy Spirit, we can have a personal relationship with God and experience his presence in our lives. But knowing that God exists requires faith. Hebrews 11:6 reminds us, without faith it's impossible to please him, and that those who come to him must believe that he exists and rewards those who earnestly seek him. So as you seek God with an open heart and the willingness to believe, he will reveal himself to you in ways that are very personal and meaningful to you. How many of you, you can raise your hand to this, how many of you have ever had an answer of prayer? Everybody in this room is raising their hand. Thank God. You know why that is? You know why you got an answer of prayer? Because God exists.
Yeah.
Amen? Because God exists. How many folks have ever seen a real miracle? Amen?
Yeah.
You know why that happened? because God exists. Yes. Oh, I know we have the medical community, and they're great, and I love my doctors and my, it's the nurse practitioner. I never see the doctor anymore. It's always the nurse practitioner. She seems to be on top of things, though, and I love her for that. And, just look at me. She's taking really good care of me, amen? Amen. But thank God for the medical community. But brother, you better be looking to God, amen? Because it is God that gives men and women knowledge to have the medical, to do the medical profession that they do, amen? It's God who enlightens them to those things. I know God exists because of His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is found in the pages of the New Testament and Old Testament alike. We only know God if He shows Himself to us. And this is exactly what He did when He came as Jesus into the world. He was God in human flesh, fully God and fully man. Once you discover who Jesus is, you'll also discover an even more amazing truth, that God loves you. That's why Jesus came. He wanted the world to see that how much God loves him. And that while we were yet sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. He wants you to live forever. Don't stay lost in the swamps of unbelief any longer, but open your heart to the life of Christ. Let Him transform you by His power today. We know that God is real because He has revealed Himself to us in four ways. It's in creation, in His Word, by His Holy Spirit, by His Son, Jesus. You know what? 1 Corinthians 15 not only defines what the gospel is, but it also tells us that Jesus was seen by more than 500 people at the same time after His resurrection. To this day, nobody has ever produced a dead body of Jesus after He was laid in the tomb. Nobody's produced that dead body. That tells me, by faith, I already know He lives. But if people are looking for physical evidence, show us a body. You can't do it. Can't do it. Amen. How can the Christian believe in God that they can't see? Well, there's several ways that God makes His presence known. Maybe some things I've mentioned will convince the skeptic, but maybe not. But any honest seeker can find God's fingerprints everywhere. The universe, in science, in testimonies from people who say that they know God. The Holy Spirit and Jesus are the testimony of God's existence also. The invisible attributes of His eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen since the world and since creation was done. These things being understood of what God has made, He says, here's the result. People are without excuse. Look at the universe. Look at the order of the universe. Look at the earth, the plant life, the animal life. Look at you. Look at DNA. There is no excuse for not knowing God. You ever wondered where your guilty conscience come from when you did something wrong? That came from God when you was created. You ever wonder why people have performed many acts of mercy? Because that came from God also. 2 Corinthians 6:16 tells us that God is the living God. Amen. Psalm 139:14 says, I will praise Thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are Thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. I really wanted to show you a video at the end of the service today, but we had some complications with the computer. I think we're going to have to upgrade it. But I'd like to just leave you with this song that is a very special song. It's called My Redeemer Lives. And the words say this: who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? Who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives. Amen. I know my Redeemer lives. All of creation testifies. This life within me cries that I know my Redeemer lives. The very same God that spins things in orbit runs to the weary and wearin and the weak. And the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken, they conquered death to bring me victory. Amen. He lives to take away my shame. And He lives forever. I'll proclaim that the payment for my sin was the precious life He gave. But now He's alive and there is an empty grave. Amen? Come on up, musicians. Let's have a song ready today. Oh, I tell you, folks, God lives, God exists, and God is real. Amen. Creation tells us, science shows us, the Bible proves it, the Holy Spirit lives inside of us and reminds us of it, and Jesus came as God in the flesh, amen, and He died for our sins, and He was buried, and He rose again, and nobody but Jesus has ever risen from the dead, amen. Hallelujah. My God lives, amen. What do we got in song here?
Every day with Jesus.
Let's all stand to our feet this morning, every day with Jesus, amen.
Is sweeter than the day before.
Yes, He is.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before.
Yes.
Every day with Jesus, I love Him more and more. Jesus saved and keeps me, and He's the one I'm waiting for.
Let's bow our hearts and let's pray this morning. There might be somebody in this audience, might be somebody in our listening audience today that's never been saved. Maybe they've been doubting God's existence. Maybe you know somebody today that doesn't believe in God. Maybe they claim to be an agnostic. They're just not sure if God's there or not. Why don't we just take a moment together and let's just pray for these folks. Let's pray that the Holy Spirit of God would help us to witness to them and show them the very existence of our God that we cannot see, but by faith, we know He's there. We believe in Him. We know He's real. The old song says, I know He's real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful, God, that You are real. We're thankful, God, that You exist. You're from eternity past. There's no God before Thee. There's no God after Thee. Thou art God. Father, we thank You for Your Son. We thank You for coming to us in that little manger. And we thank You for that day that You went to the cross of Calvary. You laid down Your life that we could be saved. You made payment for every sin that I have ever done. You made payment for every sin the world has ever done. And when You was laid in that tomb, on that third morning, the breath of God came to You and you rose up out of that grave. And You came forth, and You forever live. You forgave us our sins at the cross. You gave us eternal life through Your resurrection. And God, I pray for the agnostic listening today. I pray for the atheist that's run across this program. Maybe they've been scoffing all the way through it. But God, someday they're going to have to mean business with You. It doesn't matter if they believe in You or not. God, You're there. Someday they'll stand before You. Someday they'll have to drop their knee and confess Jesus as Lord, and I wish that they could do it now. And I pray, God, for whoever's listening, that they would trust You. Simply say, Dear God, I believe that You're there, and I believe that Your Son is Jesus. I believe He died for me. I believe He rose from the dead, just like that preacher said. And right now I'm asking You to forgive my sins, come into my life and save me. Make me Your child. Father, if they'll do that by faith, if they'll trust You today by faith, they'll get to be in heaven someday. And I pray You'll deal with that heart right now. Deal with them in a way that they've never been dealt with before. Father, we'll thank You for that. We'll praise You throughout the eons of time. When we're walking, when we're walking through that beautiful city, when we're standing on the countryside of heaven, throughout the ages of time, we'll be thankful for this day that they called upon You. Have Your way, Father. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing one more verse, Ray. One more verse today.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus.